There are three parts of our celebration. First, the liturgy of the word. We listen to the readings and join in praying the solemn intercessions. Second, the adoration of the Holy Cross. And third, Holy Communion. We will also start the novena to the Divine Mercy at the end of the service. My brothers and sisters, we remember how much God loves us. He loves us enough to suffer and die, to transform the cross into the tree of life, and to abide with us in the sacraments. A symbol of defeat and foolishness to the world, the cross is held high before us as the means by which our salvation was won. We offer contrition for our sins and thankfulness for the love and mercy of our God. May I invite you all to kneel.
Remember your mercies, O Lord, and with your eternal protection sanctify your servants, for whom Christ your Son, by the shedding of his blood, establish the paschal mystery, who lives and reigns forever and ever.
Amen.
Let us all be seated.
A reading from the book of the prophet Isaiah. See, my servant shall prosper. He shall be raised high and greatly exalted. Even as many were amazed at him, so marred was his look beyond human semblance, and his appearance beyond that of the sons of man. So shall he startle many nations. Because of him, kings shall stand speechless, for those who have not been told shall see. Those who have not heard shall ponder it. Who would believe what we have heard? To him has the arm of the Lord been revealed. He grew up like a sapling before him, like a shoot from a parched earth. There was in him no stately bearing to make us look at him, nor appearance that would attract us to him. He was spurned and avoided by people, a man of suffering, accustomed to infirmity, one of those from whom people hide their faces, spurned, and we held him in no esteem. Yet it was our infirmities that he bore, our sufferings that he endured, while we thought of him as stricken, as one smitten by God and afflicted. But he was pierced for our offenses, crushed for our sins. Upon him was the chastisement that makes us whole. By his stripes we were healed. We have all gone astray like sheep, each following his own way. But the Lord laid upon him the guilt of us all. Though he was harshly treated, he submitted and opened not his mouth. Like a lamb led to the slaughter, or a sheep before the shearers, he was silent and opened not his mouth. Oppressed and condemned, he was taken away. And who would have thought any more of his destiny? When he was cut off from the land of the living and smitten for the sin of his people. A grave was assigned him among the wicked, and a burial place with evildoers, though he had done no wrong, nor spoken any falsehood. But the Lord was pleased to crush him in infirmity. If he gives his life as an offering for sin, he shall see his descendants in a long life, and the will of the Lord shall be accomplished through him. Because of his affliction, he shall see the light in fullness of days. Through his sufferings, my servant shall justify many, and their guilt he shall bear. Therefore, I will give him his portion among the great, and he shall divide his spoils with the mighty, because he surrendered himself to death and was counted among the wicked. And he shall take away the sins of many, and win pardon for their offenses. The word of the Lord. Responsorial Psalm. Father, into your hands I commend my spirit. Father, into your hands I commend my spirit. In you, O Lord, I take refuge. Let me never be put to shame. In your justice, rescue me. Into your hands I commend my spirit. You will redeem me, O Lord, O faithful God. Father, into your hands I commend my spirit. For all my foes, I am an object of reproach, a laughingstock to my neighbors, and a dread to my friends. They who see me abroad flee from me. I am forgotten like the unremembered dead. I am like a dish that is broken. Father, into your hands I commend my spirit. But my trust is in you, O Lord. I say you are my God. In your hands is my destiny. Rescue me from the clutches of my enemies and my persecutors. Father, into your hands I commend my spirit. Let your face shine upon your servant. Save me in your kindness. Take courage and be stout-hearted, all you who hope in the Lord. Father, into your hands I commend my spirit.
A reading from the letter to the Hebrews. Brothers and sisters, since we have a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold fast to our confession. For we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weaknesses, but one who has similarly tested in every way, yet without sin. So let us confidently approach the throne of grace to receive mercy and to find grace for timely help. In the days when Christ was in the flesh, he offered prayers and supplications with loud cries and tears to the one who was able to save him from death, and he was heard because of his reverence. Son though he was, he learned obedience from what he suffered. And when he was made perfect, he became the source of eternal salvation for all who obey him. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ, King of endless glory.
Christ became obedient to the point of death, even death on the cross. Because of this, God greatly exalted him and bestowed on him the name which is above every other name.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ, King of endless glory.
The Passion of Christ. According to John.
Jesus went out with his disciples Jesus went out with his disciples across the Kidron Valley to where there was a garden into which he and his disciples entered. Judas, his betrayer, also knew the place because Jesus had often met there with his disciples. So Judas got a band of soldiers and guards from the chief priests and the Pharisees and went there with lanterns, torches, and weapons. Jesus, knowing everything that was going to happen to him, went out and said to them,
"Whom are you looking for?"
They answered him,
"Jesus of Nazareth."
He said to them,
"I am."
Judas, his betrayer, was also with them. When he said to them, "I am," they turned away and fell to the ground. So he again asked them,
"Whom are you looking for?"
They said,
"Jesus of Nazareth."
Jesus answered,
"I told you that I am. So if you are looking for me, let this man go."
This was to fulfill what he had said, "I have not lost any of those you gave me." Then Simon Peter, who had a sword, drew it, struck the high priest's slave, and cut off his right ear. The slave's name was Malchus. Jesus said to Peter,
"Put your sword into its scabbard. Shall not drink the cup that the Father gave me."
So the band of soldiers, the tribune, and the Jewish guards seized Jesus, bound him, and brought him to Annas first. He was the father-in-law of Caiaphas, who was high priest that year. It was Caiaphas who had counseled the Jews that it was better that one man should die rather than the people. Simon Peter and another disciple followed Jesus. Now the other disciple was known to the high priest, and he entered the courtyard of the high priest with Jesus. But Peter stood at the gate outside. So the other disciple, the acquaintance of the high priest, went out and spoke to the gatekeeper and brought Peter in. Then the maid, who was the gatekeeper, said to Peter,
"You are not one of this man's disciples, are you?"
He said,
"I am not."
Now the slaves and the guards were standing around a charcoal fire that they had made because it was cold, and they were warming themselves. Peter was also standing there, keeping warm. The high priest questioned Jesus about his disciples and about his doctrine. Jesus answered him,
"I have spoken publicly to the world. I have always taught in a synagogue or in the temple area where all the Jews gather. And in secret I have said nothing. Why ask me? Ask those who heard me what I said to them. They know what I said."
When he said this, one of the temple guards standing there struck Jesus and said,
"Is this the way you answer the high priest?"
Jesus answered him,
"If I have spoken wrongly, testify to the wrong. But if I have spoken rightly, why do you strike me?"
Then Annas sent him bound to Caiaphas, the high priest. Now Simon Peter was standing there, keeping warm. And they said to him,
"You are not the one of his disciples, are you?"
He denied it and said,
"I am not."
One of the slaves of the high priest, a relative of the one whose ear Peter had cut off, said,
"Did I see him or heard him?"
Again, Peter denied it, and immediately the cock crowed. Then they brought Jesus from Caiaphas to the praetorium. It was morning, and they themselves did not enter the praetorium in order not to be defiled so that they could eat the Passover. So Pilate came out to them and said,
"What charge do you bring against this man?"
They answered and said to him,
"If he were not a criminal, we would not have handed him over to you."
At this, Pilate said to them,
"Take him yourselves and judge him according to your law."
The Jews answered him,
"We are not allowed to execute anyone."
In order that the word of Jesus might be fulfilled that he said, indicating the kind of death he would die, So Pilate went back into the praetorium and summoned Jesus and said to him,
Are you the king of the Jews?
Jesus answered,
Do you say this on your own, or have others told you about me?
Pilate answered,
I am not a Jew, am I? Your own nation and the chief priest handed you over to me. What have you done?
Jesus answered,
My kingdom does not belong to this world. If my kingdom did belong to this world, my attendants would be fighting to keep me from being handed over to the Jews. But as it is, my kingdom is not here.
So Pilate said to him,
Then you are a king.
Jesus answered,
You say I am a king. For this I was born, and for this I came to the world, to testify to the truth. Everyone who belongs to the truth listens to my voice.
Pilate said to him,
What is truth?
When he had said this, he again went out to the Jews and said to them,
I find no guilt in him, but you have a custom that I release one prisoner to you at Passover. Do you want me to release to you the king of the Jews?
They cried out again,
Not this one, but Barabbas.
Now Barabbas was a revolutionary. Then Pilate took Jesus and had him scourged, and the soldiers wove a crown out of thorns and placed it on his head, and clothed him in a purple cloak, and they came to him and said,
Hail, King of the Jews.
And they struck him repeatedly. Once more, Pilate went out and said to them,
Look, I am bringing him out to you, so that you may know that I find no guilt in him.
So Jesus came out wearing the crown of thorns and the purple cloak, and Pilate said to them,
Behold, the man.
When the chief priests and the guards saw him, they cried out,
Crucify him, crucify him.
Pilate said to them,
Take him yourselves and crucify him. I find no guilt in him.
The Jews answered,
We have a law, and according to that law, he ought to die, because he made himself the Son of God.
Now when Pilate heard this statement, he became even more afraid, and went back into the praetorium and said to Jesus,
Where are you from?
Jesus did not answer him, so Pilate said to him,
Do you not speak to me? Do you not know that I have power to release you, and I have power to crucify you?
Jesus answered him,
You would have no power over me if it had not been given to you from above. For this reason, the one who handed me over to you has the greater sin.
Consequently, Pilate tried to release him, but the Jews cried out,
If you release him, you are not afraid of Caesar. Everyone makes himself a king opposes Caesar.
When Pilate heard these words, he brought Jesus out and seated him on the judge's bench in the place called Stone Pavement, in Hebrew, Gabbatha. It was preparation day for Passover, and it was about noon. And he said to the Jews,
Behold your king.
They cried out,
Take away, crucify him.
Pilate said to them,
Shall I crucify your king?
The chief priest answered,
We have no king but Caesar.
Then they handed him over to them to be crucified. So they took Jesus, and carrying the cross himself, he went out to what is called the place of the skull, in Hebrew, Golgotha. There they crucified him, and with two others, one on either side, with Jesus in the middle. Pilate also had an inscription written, and put on the cross, it read, Jesus the Nazarene, the King of the Jews. Now many of the Jews read this inscription, because the place where Jesus was crucified was near the city, and it was written in Hebrew, Latin, and Greek. So the chief priests of the Jews said to Pilate,
Do not write the King of the Jews, but that he said, I am the King of the Jews.
Pilate answered,
What I have written, I have written.
When the soldiers had crucified Jesus, they took his clothes and divided them in four shares, a share for each soldier. They also took his tunic, but the tunic was seamless, woven in one piece from the top down. So they said to one another,
let us not tear it, but cast lots for it to see whose it will be.
In order that the passage of Scripture might be fulfilled that says, they divided my garments among them, and for my vesture they cast lots. This is what the soldiers did. Standing by the cross of Jesus were his mother and his mother's sister Mary, the wife of Clopas, and Mary Magdalene. When Jesus saw his mother and the disciple there, whom he loved, he said to his mother,
woman, behold your son.
Then he said to the disciple,
behold your mother.
And from that hour, the disciple took her into his home. After this, aware that everything was now finished, in order that the scripture might be fulfilled, Jesus said,
I thirst.
There was a vessel filled with common wine, so they put a sponge soaked in this wine on a sprig of hyssop and put it up to his mouth. When Jesus had taken the wine, he said,
it is finished.
And bowing his head, he handed over his spirit.
Let us all yield. Be seated.
Now, since it was preparation day, in order that the bodies might not remain on the cross on the Sabbath, for the Sabbath day of the week was a solemn one, the Jews asked Pilate that their legs be broken and that they be taken down. So the soldiers came and broke the legs of the first and then of the other one who was crucified with Jesus. But when they came to Jesus and saw that he was already dead, they did not break his legs. But one soldier thrust his lance into his side, and immediately blood and water flowed out. An eyewitness has testified, and his testimony is true. He knows that he is speaking the truth, so that you also may come to believe. For this happened so that the scripture passage might be fulfilled. Not a bone of it will be broken. And again, another passage says, they will look upon him whom they have pierced. After this, Joseph of Arimathea, secretly a disciple of Jesus, for fear of the Jews, asked Pilate if he could remove the body of Jesus, and Pilate permitted it. So he came and took his body. Nicodemus, the one who had first come to him that night, also came, bringing a mixture of myrrh and aloes, weighing about 100 pounds. They took the body of Jesus and bound it with burial cloths, along with the spices, according to the Jewish burial custom. Now in the place where he had been crucified, there was a garden, and in the garden a new tomb, in which no one had yet been buried. So they laid Jesus there because of the Jewish preparation day, for the tomb was close by.
The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
I invited a man to join us in the Good Friday services, and he said to me, I have so much of Good Friday in my life already. It has been a year already, not just one day of suffering. It's a terrible year of the pandemic for me and my family. I lost my mom with the coronavirus. I lost my job. My wife left me. I don't know what to do. I don't know where to go. My brothers and sisters, perhaps we also claim that it has been a year of Good Friday for us, that we are so desperate, we are suffering so much, and I see we are hopeless, and we almost give up. And the question is, what good is Good Friday? Why do we call Good Friday good? All we read about it in the scriptures, all we see are images of death and suffering, love and crucifixion. What is good about this? Good Friday, we hand back to God all that we are and have, willingly, even joyfully, according to His design. That all we do, we must say for the glory of God. My brothers and sisters, we never know when we're gonna end our suffering, when the pandemic ends. But when we surrender completely ourselves to God, we know that God will take care of us. So the more we must put our trust and hope in the Lord. He is our everything. May we now stand for solemn intercessions.
Let us pray, dearly beloved, for the Holy Church of God, that our God and Lord be pleased to give her peace, to guard her and to unite her throughout the whole world, and grant that, leading our life in tranquility and quiet, we may glorify God, the Father Almighty.
Almighty, ever-living God, who in Christ revealed your glory to all the nations, watch over the works of your mercy, that your truth spread throughout the world, may persevere with steadfast faith in confessing your name through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Let us pray also for our most holy Father, Pope Francis, that our God and Lord, who chose him for the order of bishops, may keep him safe and unharmed for the Lord's holy church, to govern the holy people of God.
Almighty, ever-living God, by your decree all things are founded, look with favor on our prayers, and in your kindness protect the Pope chosen for us, that under him the Christian people, governed by you, their Maker, may grow in merit the wisdom of their faith, through Christ our Lord.
Let us pray also for our Bishop Jaime Soto, for all bishops, priests, and deacons of the church, and for the whole of the faithful people.
Almighty, ever-living God, by your Spirit, the whole body of the church is sanctified in the word. Hear our humble prayer for your ministers, that by the gift of your grace, all may serve you faithfully through Christ our Lord.
Let us pray also for catechumens, that our God and Lord may open wide the ears of their most innermost hearts and unlock the gates of His mercy, that having received forgiveness of all their sins through the waters of rebirth, they too may be one with Christ Jesus our Lord.
Almighty, ever-living God, who make your church ever fruitful with new offspring, increase the faith and understanding of catechumens, that reborn in the font of baptism, they may be added to the number of your adopted children, through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Let us pray also for all our brothers and sisters who believe in Christ, that our God and Lord may be pleased, as they live the truth, to gather them together and keep them in this one church.
Almighty ever-living God, who gather what is scattered and keep together what you have gathered, look kindly on the flock of your Son, that those whom one baptism has consecrated may be joined together in integrity of faith and united in the bond of charity through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us pray also for the Jewish people, to whom the Lord our God spoke first, that he may grant them to advance in love of his name and in faithfulness to his covenant.
Almighty ever-living God, who bestowed your promises on Abraham and his descendants, graciously hear the prayers of your church, that the people you first made your own may attain the fullness of redemption through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Let us pray also for those who do not believe in Christ, that enlightened by the Holy Spirit, they too may enter into the way of salvation.
Almighty, ever-living God, grant to those who do not confess Christ, that by walking before you with a sincere heart, they may find the truth, and that we ourselves, being constant in mutual love and striving to understand more fully the mystery of your life, may be made more perfect witnesses to your love in the world, through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Let us pray also for those who do not acknowledge God, that following what is right in sincerity of heart, they may find the way to God himself.
Almighty, ever-living God, in whose hand lies every human heart, and the rights of peoples look with favor, we pray, are those who govern with authority over us, that throughout the whole world, the prosperity of peoples, the assurance of peace, and freedom of religion, may through your gift be made secure through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Let us pray, dearly beloved, to God the Father Almighty, that he may cleanse the world of all errors, banish disease, drive out hunger, unlock prisons, loosen fetters, granting to travelers safety, to pilgrims return, health to the sick, and salvation to the dying.
Almighty, ever-living God, comfort of mourners, strength of all who toil, may the prayers of those who cry out in any tribulation come before you, that all men may rejoice, because in their hour of need, your mercy was at hand through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
I invite you now that we pray for a swift end to the coronavirus pandemic that afflicts our world, that our God and Father will heal the sick, strengthen those who care for them, and help us to persevere in faith. We may now be seated, and we now proceed to the graduation of the Holy Cross.
Behold the wounded of the cross, which sung the salvation of the world. Behold the wood of the cross, based on the salvation of the world.
Oh, come, let us adore.
Thank you.
Behold the Lamb of God, behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are they called to the supper of the Lamb.
Lord, I am not worthy to be shed under my roof, but only say the word and my soul shall be healed.
For For those who are joining us from home, may I now invite you to join me in praying the act of spiritual communion. My Jesus, I believe that you are the Blessed Sacrament. I love you above all things, and I long for you in my soul. Since I cannot now receive you sacramentally, come at least spiritually into my heart. As though you have already come, I embrace you and unite myself entirely to you. Never permit me to be separated from you. Amen.
Let us pray. Almighty ever-living God, who have restored us to life by the blessed death and resurrection of your Christ, preserve in us the work of your mercy, that by partaking of this mystery, we may have a life unceasingly devoted to you through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Bow your heads. Pray for blessing. May abundant blessing, O Lord, we pray, descend upon your people who have honored the death of your Son in the hope of their resurrection. May pardon come, comfort be given, holy faith increase, and everlasting redemption be made secure through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us all kneel. We will now start today our novena to the Divine Mercy. Novena to the Divine Mercy. Most merciful Jesus, whose very nature it is to have compassion on us and to forgive us, do not look upon our sins, but upon our trust which we place in your infinite goodness. receive us all into the fold of your most compassionate heart, and never let us escape from it. We beg this of you by your love, which denies you to the Father and the Holy Spirit. Eternal Father, turn your merciful gaze upon all mankind, and especially upon poor sinners, all enfolded in the most compassionate heart of Jesus. For the sake of his sorrowful passion, show us your mercy, that we may praise the omnipotence of your mercy forever and ever. Jesus, I trust in you.
Jesus, I trust in you. Jesus, I trust in you. Jesus, I trust in you.
For the sake of his sorrowful passion,
have mercy on us and on the whole world.
For the sake of his sorrowful passion,
have mercy on us and on the whole world.
For the sake of his sorrowful passion,
have mercy on us and on the whole world.
That it Father, Son, Holy Spirit.
Amen.
This ends our Good Friday service, and I just want to thank you for being here, and I invite you to spend this day making sacrifice, doing fasting and abstinence, and to observe great silence.